Well, good morning. What a beautiful day, nice and sunny. We're so lucky that it wasn't yesterday that we had our conference. So the weather cleared, it's a bit cold, but I'm so happy to see so many here today. And we're just gathering the rest of our attendees to come to hear our program. So I want to welcome you to Bethel Woods, the Center for the Arts, at our Sullivan Renaissance Annual Conference. And as we begin our 17th year working together to build beautiful, healthy, and active communities. To start our program today, I'm delighted to introduce the chamber singers of the Sullivan County Community Chorus, led by Kevin Giroux. And please welcome the chamber, please. Thank you so much. You really set the tone for this morning. You got us all awake and in a beautiful way. Thank you. You have such beautiful voices. We're so fortunate to have such a talented choral group in our county. And what a beautiful way to introduce our day, reflecting upon our past, but looking forward to how we will be reshaping our future. Actually, we have been reshaping our future for the past 16 years as you have all been out in your communities cleaning up your neighborhoods, tending to your public spaces, your schools, and addressing the needs of your municipalities, and what a marvelous job you're all doing. We were charged with this mission to clean up our county, not only for our own benefit, but to be more welcoming to the potential tourists coming to attend the newly built Performing Arts Center at Bethel Woods, and while here, discovering all the charms the county has to offer. During the process, we developed a new sense of pride and community spirit as we work side by side with our neighbors. In the meantime, another grave need has been looming in our county that we are all becoming aware of and without question needs to be addressed. Later this month, the new Robert Wood Johnson Foundation health rankings will be released. It has not been good in the past, and we don't expect anything different this year, but that's okay, because now we know where we stand, and more importantly, we know where we are going. Just as tourism created the need to clean up our county, the health rankings have created the need for us to address our health concerns. In that light, I would like to share with you a new effort that has emerged, Sullivan 180, a 501c3 nonprofit organization that is forming to address the health concerns of Sullivan County, and it involves each and every one of you. It is still in the early stages of formation, but I am delighted to share with you the vision of the founding members, consisting of the senior leadership of our business, our government, healthcare, and education partners. Sullivan 180 has been created to strengthen the collaborative efforts of organizations in Sullivan County that are addressing population health and our underserved communities. Its intent and mission is to raise awareness of all the efforts taking place in our county. And we have discovered that there are many who are doing this good work and addressing these issues. It is also the intent of Sullivan 180 to reduce the duplication of services and leveraging our limited resources while working to gain the attention and support of state and federal governments, as well as private foundations and grant makers. While Sullivan 180 is being organized and staffed, and hopefully soon to be operating, It is important to know that the administrative support of Sullivan 180 will be totally funded by the funding board. The founding board. They are the funding board. which has committed substantial financial resources to this effort. Any monies or grants secured through Sullivan 180 will go directly to those programs, organizations, institutions that are addressing the health and well-being of Sullivan County. It is also important to know that Sullivan 180 is not meant to replace any existing effort, but rather to be additive. Not only will Sullivan 180 work on prevention and solutions of our many health concerns, but also the overall well-being of our county. This would include our economic challenges, addiction, lack of transportation, walkability on our streets and roads, access to healthy food, support of local farmers, improving school lunches, after-school activities, food pantries, the concerns of our senior population. In other words, an overall umbrella approach that unites the entire community, including businesses, government, environment, the arts, and faith-based institutions. We believe that Sullivan 180 will be a vehicle where everyone can participate at various levels to collectively improve our overall health and well-being, just as Sullivan Renaissance was that vehicle that addressed beautification and fostered community pride and spirit. This will be a grassroots effort towards healthy, vibrant, economically sound future. Everyone, including myself, can do something to improve one's own health and well-being, to make positive changes in our personal behavior and lifestyle one degree at a time. We can be a role model for our children and support our families in this effort. Our leadership can aid us by making healthy choices easily available and accessible through changes in policy. With it all, this is not instant gratification. This will not be instant gratification. It will be difficult to turn our health rankings around. It's an issue with many layers and complexities, and it will be imperative to prioritize our efforts. Sullivan 180 is committed to change by degrees. It will be the kind of slow, steady transformation that is thoughtfully conceived and implemented. However, we can address that low-hanging fruit that will make an immediate difference in our overall health, while working on prevention through education and awareness. The timing could not be better, as Sullivan County is poised with opportunity and a new spirit of collaboration. So we are calling upon you to help move this effort forward. It has to be a team effort on all fronts of healthy living. We must all be part of that change in all that we do for ourselves, our children, and grandchildren. Now that we are on the cusp of economic opportunity with the advent of several resorts coming into our county, here are a few things we should consider. Are we preparing for this economic opportunity? Are our schools ready to accept new students? Is there housing for families? Are we ready for the new jobs available? Now is the time to prepare. So we invite you to sign on and participate in any capacity you feel comfortable and are able to contribute and promote good health and wellness in our community. We shall keep you advised of our progress and the official launch of Sullivan 180 that hopefully will be in the near future. In closing, I invite you to look at our logo that was created with the help of Fisher Mears. You will notice a turtle. As we were deciding what to call ourselves that would distinguish us from other efforts throughout the country, we wanted to bring this concept back to Sullivan County, an historical place of healing. We were thinking of the Lenape Indians, whose totem was the turtle, symbolizing Mother Earth, health, and happiness. How perfect for us, as we know the turtle keeps a slow, steady, and enduring pace that always comes out the winner. And if anyone has any questions or comments, I'll be available during the lunch hour. I'm happy to, you know, share anything with you and to garner your support. We have a table in the back where you can sign on in any capacity that you feel you'd like to participate or to hear more about Sullivan 180. We've been working, one of the reasons I wanted to introduce this as a soft rollout today is that we are in the community really working with all our Renaissance partners, and you're part of that group, and I wanted you to know about this this now. And as we've been in the community, we have been gaining more and more partners and bringing them to the table. And a new partner is Arch Care through Catholic Charities. And outside, during this day at the front door, or right over there, you'll see the Arch Care mobile unit that will be doing health screenings and also Catskill Regional Hospital is downstairs doing their screenings. We should be a very healthy group by the end of the day. So please, I hope you avail yourself of the opportunity to get your pressure checked or just to make some inquiries. But we're very grateful to Arch Care and our many partners that are coming on even beyond our county borders. For an example, Mount St. Mary College wants to work with us. So it's very exciting, and I hope you'll be part of this process. And not only would you join in some way, but any little change that you can make in your personal life, your personal choices, will benefit the whole, you know, benefit you, benefit your family. So you'll be hearing more about this in the future, in times to come. But we are so delighted to have Senator Bonasek here with us today. He has been so supportive of Sullivan 180 and was instrumental in bringing this program to the attention of the Health Department in Albany. Please welcome Senator Bonasek to the stage.
First of all, good morning. It's always wonderful to be here in a new year with Renaissance starting their program. You know, I was thinking, I've been a senator here for 19 years. This is Renaissance's 17th year. So I've watched it grow. I've watched the thousands and thousands of volunteers that have come on to work hard to make their county more beautiful. Even when the level of hope was low. What I see happening now in the next 5 years is wealth is going to come into this county. There's going to be more glitzy stories of this business locating here and jobs being created. Come to the destination resort for wellness and have fun and bring your family. We have the beautiful assets of the mountains and the rivers. And you're going to see a lot of stories and the growing of wealth in Sullivan County in the next 5 years. And then I see that Renaissance with this 180 has taken on a tremendous challenge, trying to prove the health care of people who need it is extremely difficult. When Sandra says it's complex, it's very complex and it's expensive and there are a lot of layers. And to think that Renaissance wants to take this mission on, because normally when you take a mission on, you want to know your end game is to be always successful. And you're going to need the help of a lot of people, a lot of partners, and a lot of sponsors to improve the quality of people's lives and their health. But the immediate message that goes out that I'm hearing is that those that need help, that are not healthy in a good way, they're hearing a message of we care. They're hearing a message that there's people out there that are going to be working to make your life better. So already, that message in and of itself is a wonderful, wonderful start. And let me say in conclusion, 5 years from now, when they're all talking about how great Sullivan is and how it's growing and more businesses and the wealth, and with wealth will come more money for other partners in beautification, I'm going to remember the 17 years, this being the 17th, of the thousands of volunteers and sponsors that toiled in the trenches every day to keep Sullivan County strong. You will always be the heart and soul of Sullivan County. Thank you.
That was so well said, John. That was excellent. You are. You're the heart and soul, and there wouldn't be a Renaissance without all of you in your community. So we thank you. We'd also like to recognize Assemblywoman Aileen Gunther for her unwavering support of Sullivan Renaissance and Sullivan 180. Aileen? Oh, there you are. Oh, yes. Do you want to say anything?
I don't know if you know, my maiden name is Aileen Mary Bridget Malone, so I'm a big old Irish girl. So, first and foremost, Sandra, I have to thank you for all you've done for Sullivan County. You know, you've done amazing work, and I go from town to town. Your footprint is all over Sullivan County, and we thank you. And I have to mention your staff, too. They are so cooperative, and they work every day for the betterment of Sullivan County. Denise and everybody that works with you, we are so proud of you. And to each and every one of the volunteers, again, as we look from town to town, you see so much progress, and the progress wouldn't have happened without the heart and soul of our community, so I want to thank you. And I know there's a lot of recipients today that are getting awards, and it's well-deserved, and I'm going to mention one person from the next with the next generation. Iris, I don't know if you're here, but Iris is a breath of fresh air. She's a new generation of Sullivan County, and you know, I really believe that through the example of all of you, Iris will keep going forward with Sullivan County. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Aileen, thank you. I'm having a hard time here this morning. Oh, you have. Oh. Well, when you say my footprint is all over the county, but I'm like a centipede. I have 100 other people behind me with their footprints. But I'd like to welcome the chairman of the legislature, Luis Alvarez. He's been very involved in supporting and addressing the health concerns in Sullivan County. Luis?
Thank you so much. Good morning. First, let me recognize my fellow legislators with sitting here with me today, Scott Samuelson. I don't know where you are, sitting in the back over there. Scott promised me there was going to be a Spanish translator for me here today, so I don't know. Nadia Resch, and our county manager, Josh, sitting over there. During the years that I worked for the sheriff's office, over 30 years, I used to patrol the roads, and they gave me this, when I first started, it was a red and white car, then we changed to white and black. And I had the opportunity to really get paid to see the beauty of Sullivan County and to meet most of the people that today I share the position I have as a legislator. But one amazing thing that I always remember is that at the beginning of the Renaissance projects, I used to drive around and stop and see all these volunteers working on a garden, especially in Swan Lake. Nancy used to be so persistent in her gardens, and I kept driving around the county and looking at them, and I was always wondering, why would people want to volunteer the only day they got off? That's Saturday, that's Sunday. But they did not only volunteer, they were passionate about what they were doing. And they were so proud of the work they were doing. And they wanted to show you what they were doing. And today we're honoring some volunteers, close friends of mine too that we always talk. And I want to recognize what makes us in our life be so proud of what we're doing. It doesn't matter if you're in a political position, it doesn't matter in the job you're doing, but when you volunteer, when you take time of your life to do something to make Sullivan County so beautiful, so composed in one to really the way we're moving forward. So it's my honor today to recognize the volunteers. I would like to also thank Sandra and the 180. I've been participating on the 180 since the beginning. To take such a task, it took us at least, I will say, about 8 or 9 months. Nancy McGrath must be sitting around here someplace, because I saw her at the beginning, to really understand the tasks that we were taking over to making Sullivan County healthy, and to see so many people participate on making Sullivan County healthy. I will say that, like the trails, which is one of my biggest peps that I always talk, talking to Freda and Heather, which I seem to be always looking for. Sullivan County has a lot. It's such a healthy place to be. Thank you so much for inviting me, something so much for sharing, and thank you so much for what you've done for us, for Sullivan County.
Thank you, Lewis. So over the years, Sullivan Renaissance has had the pleasure of working with thousands of community volunteers. All our volunteers are special in their own unique way, but today we'd like to say a few brief words in memory of a special volunteer from Roscoe who passed away a few days ago after a brief illness. Elaine Fedick and her husband Doug originally came to Sullivan County as second homeowners in 2007 after she retired from a successful career in the financial industry. Elaine quickly immersed herself in the community and became a local fixture in Roscoe. She served as president of the Roscoe-Rockland Chamber of Commerce for several years and was a driving force behind Roscoe winning the Sullivan Renaissance Golden Feather Grant in both 2008 and 2010. The following year, she successfully spearheaded a media campaign to get Roscoe declared the ultimate fishing town by the World Fishing Network, which came with a $25,000 prize to promote the community as a fishing destination. Elaine was a community champion who not only tirelessly volunteered her time to improve her community, but she went one step further to invest in Roscoe. Elaine and a small group of other locals founded the Roscoe Beer Company in 2013. Since then, she stepped down as chamber president, but continued to stay actively involved with beautification efforts and organizing community events, while also serving on the board of directors of the Sullivan County Visitors Association. Elaine was a one-of-a-kind community spark plug who was an inspiration to many, and we were lucky to have had a chance to be part of her life. We will miss Elaine as a wonderful Sullivan Renaissance volunteer, an important part of our Renaissance family, just as all of you are. So Elaine, we will miss you. Now on to the next part of our program, what's new for Sullivan Renaissance. But I know one new thing that I can talk about right now. I am just so delighted that that Denise Frangipani, who's been with Sullivan Renaissance right from the very beginning, from day one of its creation, and has been working with us just wonderfully over all these years, is now our executive director. Yes. And not only does she deserve this position. Like I said, I'm having a hard time this morning. I don't know. But not only does she deserve this position, but she has earned it so much, and she's been doing a fabulous job, and she supports me in so many wonderful ways. I need something, I turn around, and guess what? It's there. So she's wonderful, and she's always out, just historically, always out in the community doing wonderful things for her family, for herself, and for the community at large. So Denise is going to carry on the next part of the program, so please welcome our new executive director, Denise Frangipani.
Thank you. Now I have to try to read. Okay. See, now that I have this position, I have to prepare my remarks. And they have to be really big, because I can't read as easy as I used to, and so I'm going to put these on. Okay, good morning. As Sandra said, it is so nice to see everyone this morning. And I want to start by thanking Bethel Woods for again being our gracious host and having us in this beautiful space on this beautiful, cold but clear day. As March lives up to its reputation of coming in like a lion, we patiently await the arrival of spring. I trust that you've enjoyed a glimpse of spring this morning, and for this we would like to acknowledge Robert Hayes and the students of Tri-Valley for the fragrant and beautiful blooms, along with Sandy Nackley, Diana Wiener, Ari Mirapontier, and Greg Latorto, and the Bethel Woods facility for setting up the beautiful displays that have given us this taste of spring this morning. As executive director at Renaissance, I have the good fortune of helping to lead the organization that is built solidly on support from the Gary Foundation, along with 16 years of grassroots movement of revitalization, a team of dedicated professionals who stand ready to work with our communities and our volunteers, a wonderful steering committee, many of whom are here with us today. It is your commitment and relentless determination that has made the change in Sullivan County that we see in each hamlet, each village, and every town. I'm inspired by your passion, and I'm excited about the work ahead. And speaking of the work ahead, at Sullivan Renaissance, we have evolved from an organization with the mission to enhance the county and its appearance into a movement, and it's a movement to build beautiful, healthy, active communities. At our core, we have been about beautification, and we've used that as a tool. It's been a vehicle for building community. But today, we are more than flowers. We are municipal partnerships. We are multicultural outreach, youth engagement, business assistance, edible gardens, and creating a sense of place. So, to aid in this work, in 2017, please look for the Renaissance Collection. This is what it looks like now. It has a new look, but the Renaissance Collection continues to be a tool for designing gardens that will be sustainable in our climate, resistant to the harshness of the weather and its additives, and not so appetizing to the critters, we hope. You will find these handy guides and their recommended plants at our area nurseries and garden centers, some of whom are here today. And if you don't see them, ask for them, and we'll get them there. Introducing Kathleen Haynes. Kathleen, will you stand? Where are you, Kathleen? There's Kathleen. Kathleen is joining our staff on Monday as our horticulture coordinator, and she'll be working with Diana and Kara to assist you in your garden efforts. Kathleen will also be joined this season by former Renaissance intern Jane Hyman. There's Jane. Jane's still at school. We have great confidence in Jane because she spent 3 years apprenticing with Nancy Levine in Swan Lake, so we know she can do the job. Programa de Becas Multicultural. How'd I do? Ari, how'd I do? And speaking of which, if you would like to enjoy the rest of the program in Spanish, we have simultaneous Spanish translation going on right now in this program, and we have headsets available in the lobby if you'd like to participate. We have broadened our efforts to connect with our multicultural neighbors and our community through two new programs focused on outreach and neighborhood grants. We've also added property enhancement grants for seasonal communities and businesses. Please visit Ari Mirpontier and Alan Frischman at the Multicultural Outreach Display in the lower level when we have our break. Sullivan Renaissance has incredible community partners. The Center for Workforce Development continues to work with us to bring youth development opportunities and our internship program, now called Project Assistance. We rarely work alone. We continue to partner with the Sullivan County Division of Planning, and I know Freda, I think the whole department is here today. Freda, Jill, Mark, and Heather are all here today, our Division of Planning for the county. Together we work to aid communities in their planning and economic development goals. We continue to work with Catskill Mountain Keeper on the Catskill Edible Garden Project to build edible gardens in our communities and create the next generation of food entrepreneurs. Yay. We're having a great time working with Cornell Cooperative Extension to focus our efforts and leverage resources related to healthy communities. Salad bars and snowshoes in every school of the county. That's our goal. Many of our partners are here today, and we ask that you visit with them while you're spending your time with us. Through our work with Sullivan 180, we've developed many new partnerships, including working with our public health department, and Nancy McGraw is here, or she was here. She's still here, Nancy. One of our unsung heroes. And Catskill Regional Medical Center, who also set up here today. Catskill Regional has taken the lead on organizing a training for worksite wellness coordinators. It's not enough to say you want to create wellness in your workplace. Someone needs to lead that. And this training comes at the perfect time as we consider the impact of health in our economy. Amanda Langseder, the Director of Community Health, is here today, and she's set up in the lobby to share with you information about this program that's coming up. It's very exciting. We are embracing digital media. Well, some of us are. Today, we are actually webcasting live, and greetings to all who are watching at home. While you're with us today, we invite you to share your experiences via Twitter. Let's see if we can out-tweet others. And you can, since I will never remember it, please refer to this, oh, not that one, but the other screen before. We've accomplished so much together and over these last years, and yet we have more to do. It was Dr. Seuss week this week, if you have any relation to schools. We have many places to go. When we consider how to impact the quality of life in Sullivan County, our local communities are our best hope for forging a sustainable, healthy future for ourselves, our children, and those who come after. Individual projects, one town and one village at a time, are already having an incredible impact. This is the beauty of Sullivan County and the amazing spirit of Sullivan Renaissance. So thank you so much. And in that spirit, it is my pleasure to introduce steering committee member and my friend, Dali Veglianti, who will present this year's Renaissance Awards. Dali?
Good morning. Yes, I am Dali. I'm a proud member of the Sullivan Renaissance Steering Committee. This morning, we are pleased to present the Renaissance Awards. These awards are given to individuals, organizations, and businesses in recognition of their remarkable contributions to the beautification and community development efforts throughout Sullivan County. Renaissance is defined as the activity, spirit, or time of a great revival. Each of today's award recipients represent a renaissance, a transition, a vigor, a rebirth, and recognize a sense of pride and community spirit. In the spirit of Sullivan Renaissance, we ask, have you renaissance today? The answer for our recipients being honored here is an absolute yes. Today's recipients will receive a framed photo and statement of their recognition, as well as citations from New York State Senator John Bonasek, Assemblywoman Aileen Gunther, and the Sullivan County Legislature. We ask that as you are called, please come onto stage and receive your award and pose for a photo. I would also like to invite Fred Stabbert of the Sullivan Renaissance Steering Committee to help present the awards. There you are, Fred. Our Spirit Award is given for outstanding efforts in the community service area, someone with a special attitude and a spirit that helps to shape our community. Our Spirit Award is being presented to Isaac Green Dybul. Isaac lives in Calicoon. Good morning. Isaac lives in Calicoon, New York. He operates the film company Green Dybul and serves as the co-director for Engine. Engine is an educational organization for social, civic, and creative practice. Isaac also teaches at the New School Parsons and is currently the president of the Hortonville Volunteer Fire Company, serves on the Town of Delaware Planning Board, steering committee member of Sullivan Agencies Leading Together. He is a member of the Sullivan County Legislative Chairman's Healthy Sullivan Initiative and a steering committee member of the Calicoon Visioning Committee. Isaac was formerly on the Sullivan County Human Rights Commission, Sullivan County Charter Review Commission, Vice President of Sullivan Alliance for Sustainable Development, Town of Delaware Fire Advisory Board, and Vice President for the Calicoon Business Association. If that was not enough, Isaac also found the time to learn how to play beautiful piano, and it was Isaac who was playing this morning as you all came in. Isaac, we thank you. We thank you for wearing so very many hats and for showing us your community spirit. Would you like to say a word?
Sullivan County, so lovin'. My friend Keith reminded me that. Have any of you ever been in love? Have any of you ever felt love or love someone? Come on, right? Some of you have. Some of you. Think of that person, think of that feeling. Hold on to that feeling. You're gonna need it. There are so many different people in this world. And we don't all get along necessarily or have the same beliefs or feel the same way about things. And some of the people I love most in this county are incredibly different than me. They voted for a different president than me. They have different politics than me. And we work together to make this world a better place, despite that difference. In Tibetan language, there is a word, redok, which simultaneously means hope and fear. Two different sides of one feeling. And I wonder, how is that? What is this feeling? What is this thing? And I realize vulnerability. Vulnerability. To have fear, perhaps, of something so great, a love maybe, but to be able to approach it, approach that fear, and find once you have confronted that fear, on the other side is hope. And I think this symbol is so important for me and my work and the work that I know so many of us are doing here today. And I hope, I know that the people in this room, we have the courage to confront with vulnerability those fears, to love those who are different than us.
And a great speaker as well. The Transformation Award is given to recognize a substantial transformation, renovation, or overhaul, a complete change in appearance. Today, we will present two Transformation Awards. Our first Transformation Award is being presented to Salt and Pepper the Kitchen. In 2006, two artists from New York City came to Monticello and opened a deli called Salt and Pepper the Kitchen. For the next 10 years, Il Nam and Nam Yi, the chefs and owners, strived to bring New York City quality sandwiches and authentic down-home Korean cooking to Monticello. Now they have invested even further in Monticello and upgraded that deli into a full-fledged restaurant. They have used their artistic talents to create a space that is elegant and homey, with a renovation using calming colors and their favorite art pieces inside and charming umbrella tables outside. You might think, deli-style sandwiches and Korean food? Well, it's delicious. They are not only skilled and talented as chefs in a variety of cuisines, but also have hearts as big as the great outdoors. Il Nam and Nam Yi and the rest of the staff at Salt and Pepper strive to bring you the best food and dining experience in a truly pleasant and unique dining area. Their philosophy is not make money any way you can, but serve and love your neighbor the best way that you can. We thank you for filling our bellies and for being such great hosts, and accepting the award is Il Nam. Thank you, Ronnie. Did you want to say anything?
No? I came to Sullivan County 12 and a half years ago with nothing. And I started as an artist in New York City, and somehow, some reason, I decided to fold all those motivation, and then I came here 12 and a half years ago with empty hand, but I'm here with present condition, with lots of friends, and I'm so happy, and I'm so thankful, all of you. Thank you.
Our second Transformation Award is being presented to the Rose Haven Boutique and Mill in Bethel, New York. This project is the result of a partnership between property owners Jair and Luz Trujillo and Rose Haven proprietors Rob Bruce and Michelle Amour. Rob and Michelle own an alpaca farm. They breed alpacas and participate in events to sell alpaca products. They have been looking for a place to start a mill in Sullivan County when Jair came upon the abandoned Bethel property that was up for auction. The property would perfectly accommodate a mill in the garage and a retail store in the house. They decided to work together on the property renovations. Although the house was sold as a 1940s house, when Rob began removing the siding, he found the original board and batten, which is traditional to Gothic-style houses of the 1800s. Once you start a project like that, they said there's no going back. Jair and Luz did the main work on the house and the mill. The hope is that this house will live on in its original style for many years to come. We thank you for keeping the old charm and the alpacas right here in Sullivan County. Accepting the award is Bob, Jair, Luis, and Michelle.
I'd like to thank you very much for this. We've been up here for 23 years now. And I remember sitting on the Delaware River with a bunch of friends and some adult beverages saying, gee, I'd like to bring some jobs here and maybe, you know, give something back to the community. And so we kept our farm as a farming situation. We have 116 animals at this point in time. And when this opportunity arose, it gave us the opportunity to make some things here and to do a little renovation as well. Thank you very much for the award.
The Earth Award, that is given to for taking extra strides to incorporate sustainable standards with consideration for protecting the environment and preserving natural resources. The Earth Award this year is being presented to the Bashakil Area Association. Throughout 45 years, the Bashakil Area Association, a volunteer environmental group, has consistently followed its mission of protecting the Bashakil wetlands and surrounding areas and preserving the area's beauty at the same time. They have combined educational strategies like Nature Watch, water testing, and Come Clean with advocacy, and have enlightened countless residents and visitors about the wetlands, crucial role in our ecosystem and subsequent need for conservation. They promote the Bashakil's value as an economically sustainable component of ecotourism. Since 1972, tireless efforts by hundreds of Bashakil Area Association volunteers in myriad venues have ensured the Bashakil Area Association's current effectiveness as a dynamic, positive community presence. They credit part of their success to the ongoing support of vital partners and appreciate the recognition, which encourages them to work even harder on behalf of a critical Sullivan County natural resource. I remember Denise and I doing the Eagle Watch there. We thank you for teaching and caring about the environment, and accepting the award today is Paula Medley. Thank you, Paula.
Thank you so much, Sullivan Renaissance, and particular thanks to the incredible hundreds of BKA volunteers who have labored, as we said before, tirelessly for 45 years for the benefit of this county. Thank you.
The Collaboration Award is given for outstanding commitment and volunteerism with multiple groups to achieve a positive impact working together. The Collaboration Award this year is presented to Sullivan Agencies Leading Together, also known as SALT. SALT is a diverse partnership of agencies and community resources committed to working together to improve the quality of life for the residents of Sullivan County. Through information sharing, increased prevention efforts, and the interagency collaboration, they seek to improve access to services that empower members of our community to make lasting and positive changes. By working together, they intend to get to know the residents of Sullivan County, recognize their needs, and connect them to services. They want to be visible and easily accessible in our community, at events, and on the street to help to make things happen through referrals and proper connections. What they say is SALT is you, it's me, it is all of us working together to create a spirit of hope. We thank you for working together with so many to help so many more. And accepting the award today is Martin Calavito.
If anybody here has come to a meeting or a SALT member, just stand up for 1 second, please. All right, we got some folks there. We got Isaac and Tom, get up. To be considered is an incredibly powerful thing. And one of the things that these guys who just stood up do is they consider people. And they do it by doing outreach. But what we try to do that wasn't in the bio is provide a hug, a human touch, that reminds people that at any given time, we are in need. We are in need. Everybody in this room is in need. And that by walking the streets and doing this type of outreach and extending ourselves to people, we are able to not only connect with them, but also make people a part of our community and a part of solutions, become a community of solutions, right? So we all thank you very much for considering us. There's no better feeling in the world, and we know that because we feel it when we consider others. But there is an ask. Everything we do ends with an ask. And you know, you may want to consider walking with us one day. You may want to consider taking a walk with Isaac. You know, we can't get rid of this guy, you know. Take a walk with Isaac, take a walk with us, because you just might touch somebody who's forgotten what it feels like to be touched, all right? You know, or you might have forgotten what it feels like to touch somebody. But the most important reason we should walk together because we are better together. Everybody in this room makes us better. And SALT is nothing without that heart and that spirit. So I thank you very much, and hopefully some of you guys would consider that ask and walk with us. Have a good day.
Thank you. The SPARK Award is given to a youth for making a difference in the community and helping to germinate volunteerism. The SPARK Award today is being presented to Iris Gillingham. We'll get to how much Iris is working on, but Iris couldn't be here today because she is doing so much, and this is Iris's mom, Amy Gillingham. And we'll just take a moment to recognize the wonderful daughter that she has raised. The 17 years old Iris Fenn Gillingham has been raised and homeschooled on her family's farm. She is an artist and an independent thinker. She loves history. She is passionate about her Celtic heritage. Iris works on her family's farm and raises heritage breeds of sheep. In her young years, Iris has been a journalist, served on the Chandelier Music Festival's Youth Advisory Board, was involved with Project Identity at Bethel Woods, and performed in the Weather Project with NACL Theater. She has advocated and testified for protecting the land and water she loves. At the age of 12, Iris was one of four youths to speak to the Delaware River Basin Commission to ask for a moratorium on fracking. Most notably, Iris is a member of the Earth Guardians Youth Council. With that council, she collaborates with 17 other young people from around the world and North America to speak for her generation about environmental, climate, and social justice issues. She travels around the country, meeting with other organizations, speaking on youth engagement and sustainability. She serves as the regional youth director for Earth Guardians New York. Iris is currently attending Sullivan County Community College and has started an Earth Guardians there, where she is working with youth on campus to lift up their voices in the greater community. Iris believes that we live in a time when we need to question our accepted systems and status quo. She says it is our responsibility to imagine a sustainable and just world, and by working together using our creativity, we can build it. We thank Iris for speaking out, standing up, and being a great example for youth and for sparking others. And while she is off changing the world, accepting this award today is her mom, Amy Gillingham. We thank you for raising such a wonderful daughter.
Thank you so much.
To all our award recipients, we thank you for everything you have done to transform Sullivan County, one person, one place, one community at a time. We are proud to honor you, and we hope your efforts have inspired more people to Renaissance. I'll leave you today with a quote by Edith Wharton. There are two ways of spreading light, to be the candle or the mirror that reflects it. We thank you all.
Should we stretch? Everyone feel like we want to take a quick stretch before we move on to the keynote portion of our program. But before we do, I also would like to recognize Nancy Buck, our county treasurer, who's here today. She always makes the time to join us, and to thank Nancy and all the others who are working so hard together on the new land bank. And that's part of what Nancy's working on as our county treasurer. So thank you, Nancy. I mentioned our partnership with Cornell Cooperative Extension earlier, and I would like to acknowledge that Cornell was helpful in that we partnered with Cornell to bring our keynote speaker to Sullivan County this weekend through their Healthy School and Community Grant Program. So I have the opportunity now and the pleasure to introduce our keynote, who will be speaking for the morning portion and also leading a workshop this afternoon. Cynthia Nikitin is Senior Vice President for the Project for Public Spaces in New York City. She's been there for 25 years, and the Project for Public Spaces does a lot of work that's similar to what we do in Sullivan County. They have a different toolbox and a different approach, and it's really engaging, hands-on, on-the-street kind of work. At the Project for Public Spaces, Cynthia is currently directing the Citizens Institute on Rural Design, which is a leadership initiative of the National Endowment for the Arts. It focuses on bringing this design assistance to rural communities and small towns. The program is committed to leveraging the power of placemaking to strengthen connections between people and the place they share, and to spark social, economic, and environmental benefits in communities. Joining Cynthia this weekend was Elka Gottfried, project manager, and together we walked the streets in Monticello yesterday as well as in Conianga Lake. So please join me in giving a Sullivan County welcome to Cynthia Nikitin from the Project for Public Spaces.
Thank you, Denise. Thank you, everyone, for coming out today on this very brisk, blustery, refreshing, clearing the air, clearing your head, clearing your sinuses kind of a day. Thank you. Just gonna hope it's up there. Just get this going. I'm not sure. Oh, there we go. All right. I haven't practiced this a bit. So building communities through placemaking. I'm just really honored to be sharing the stage with so many amazing people from the community, from the county, who are so devoted and fiercely passionate about their communities, their villages, their towns. At PPS, we would dub you zealous nuts. And it's a compliment, you know. It's the fact that without people that are in love with their place, in love with their communities, nothing really can happen. Margaret Mead was very clear about this. You know, the only change that can happen is a small group of committed individuals working together to make a difference. And William White, who was our founder and mentor, was talking about the importance of small spaces. These insignificant little spaces, the spaces where you run into a neighbor in front of the post office, or you're at the laundromat and you see your elementary school teacher. These sort of encounters, these spaces that are the wealth of what public social life is built from. And that's what we focus on at Project for Public Spaces. We focus on the public realm, on buildings, infrastructure, streets, roads, waterfronts, plazas, anything that is built with public dollars, tax dollars, that creates the shared value of the public realm. And very often, we kind of take these buildings for granted. Or it's hard to love, you know, a bus station. You know, it's hard to love a police station. It's easier to love a library, very easy to love a library. But these are all things that we have purchased. We have, with our tax dollars, built, created, and they serve us. But we don't feel that we leverage them, the value of them, as facilities, as places, as anchor destinations in our community as much as we should. So we look to those levels of civic institutions and that public infrastructure as a way of creating bridges between communities and other state and county level organizations, but really looking at how we can maximize the value of those institutions, of those facilities, to support community growth and development. Okay, so I just need to know where to, okay. I'm just gonna push buttons until it changes. So, what is placemaking? How many of you have heard this word before, placemaking? I've got a few hands. Okay, I'm gonna ask you sort of to think about it. So you know that if, you know what to make is, right? To make something, it's a verb, very easy. Place is a little bit less of a concept that people, I think, really come to understand. You know, to make something, if you're a shoemaker, you make shoes, you put things together, you construct, you cause something to exist or come about. But in terms of making a place, and I'm gonna talk more about what a place is, putting these two concepts together is what we do. And basically, places are the combination of space and meaning. Places are spaces that have meaning. So places are physical geographic locations. This is a place, this is a physical place, a public space, an art center, a community center, a farm, a place full of memories and history that's deeply connected to its community. But the meaning of this place, Bethel Woods Center for the Arts, is very different for different people. People may remember it, of course, as where the Woodstock concert happened. People who are significantly younger than I am may just know that it's a great multicultural art center that has great concerts, and that whole history really doesn't resonate with them. We were talking yesterday with some folks, and I was like wondering why it took so long for people to rediscover this space and rebuild it and recreate it as an art center. And I was told, well, there's another meaning to this place in 1969. Chaos, havoc, hundreds of thousands of people towing cars out of here for 3-4 months after the concert, no benefit to local business, destruction of property, wantonness, randomness, drugs, alcohol, you name it. It was like Sodom and Gomorrah. And I also heard that because of that memory of this place, and I don't have all my facts, but I never let the facts get in the way of a good story, there was a real reticence on the part of the town and the municipality to actually permit use for many years, or to sell it, or to let it be used, because this idea that once you open the floodgates every weekend, it's going to be Woodstock 1969 over and over and over again forever. So the memory and meaning of this place for people who were living in this community and experienced that, very different from many of you who might have even attended the concert, which is very different from me who wanted to go, but I was like only 11 and I couldn't go. My parents wouldn't let me. To younger generations that just think that they wish they were here, you know. So these spaces have a lot of different meaning for different people, and how you tap into that wealth and the experiences of that, and put all those pieces together and connect all those dots and see how you can honor all of those perceptions and all of those perspectives moving forward is really about what placemaking is. It's not necessarily a profession, which is great, because my mother finally understands what I do, but she thinks I'm an urban planner, which is kind of part of what it is. It's really this discipline. It intersects so many different kinds of disciplines and talents and abilities. So I think that everyone in this room is a placemaker, because you do 10 different things. You have 10 different skills and assets, and bringing them together, but to focus on locations, on communities, on gateways, the greening, the planting, you know, around a church or a library facility. It's all about those physical connections, going to those physical locations. But it really relies on the best professional knowledge and skill, but it doesn't leave it up to landscape architects, engineers, civil engineers, traffic engineers to make it happen. Those are resources and facilitators, but it's really about empowering local communities to take ownership of the process of basically shaping the built environment and planning for their future and tapping into your innate knowledge, experience, wisdom, and history in a collective, collaborative process that brings out the best of you and pairs you with designers and architects that can actually bring your vision to reality. So we feel that the design profession is in service to the community, and the community is always the client. So a lot of our work is about helping you be the best clients you can be and giving you knowledge and information to be able to navigate, you know, those kinds of longer term development, economic development, and design processes. So this, I didn't want to go back. Okay. This is what we do. It's a little hard to read this. If it was a cloudy, snowy, horrible day, you'd read my slides really well. This is being filmed. You'll be able to see it again, but because the sun is out, it's a little harder. But this process, which starts with defining the place, identifying the stakeholders, evaluating the space, coming up with the place vision, short-term experiments, and then making longer-term changes. Our process for working with communities on transformation is very much like, it's analogous to seeking medical treatment. It's very much places are the patient. So when you go to a doctor, what is the first thing a doctor will ask you? Just, okay, you have to speak up because I can't hear. Did you say, do you have insurance? I go to Canada, They don't say that. That's not the first question that comes out of their mouths. Anyone else? Why are you here? Exactly. Why are you here? What's wrong with you? What's been going on? You know, how are you feeling? So that's the first thing we do, is we go into a community and we say, hey, Monticello, how are you? What's going on? What's been happening in your community? What are some of the issues that you're facing? What are some of the challenges that you're up against? What are some of the opportunities that you may have that you're not really sure how to take advantage of? But we talk to not just the town, we talk to all the community members, as many stakeholders as we can, to get their perception on how Monticello is doing as a patient. And then what's the next thing you do? You go in, you talk to the doctor, he asks you about, what does he ask you about? He takes your medical history, and that's also part of the process, is talking to other partners that are in the area, that are in the community, about what they think. And then what happens after that, after he figures out, you know, kind of what's been going on? What does he do then, or she? Okay, this is, people say, makes a diagnosis. I love that. I go into a doctor and I say, the symptom is I have a headache, and he says, you have a brain tumor. Everyone worries about, no, there's a middle step, right? She runs tests. She runs a battery of tests. She takes your vitals, she takes your blood, or does an x-ray, send you for an MRI, to do some tests to identify what is the cause. And those are the tools that we use. We go out on site, and we did this in Kanyanga Lake, and we did this in Monticello with our little toolkit to evaluate, to run some tests, to kind of evaluate how the patient, how these communities were doing. And checking their vitals, checking what it felt like to cross the street, looking at retail vacancies, looking at how different institutions partnered together, looking at how comfortable it is. If you're an older person or you're shopping, is there a place to sit? Can you get something to eat? Is there a shaded seating area? What is the connection between the parking and the main street? How are the businesses doing? We did our tests. And then after you do the tests, you come back with some sort of a diagnosis, which we vision as, come up with as the vision. What is the vision for moving this place forward? We understand what the problems are. So the diagnosis, the vision is how do we move forward? And at that point, and the vision I'll go through in terms of our place diagram, and at that point, we come up with the treatment plan. How are we going to treat this patient? Is it for a human? Is it diet? Is it exercise? Is it some different kinds of medicines, et cetera? And we test it. We do the treatment plan. Now, when you go to the doctor, they don't say, here's a bunch of pills and here's your x-ray results. I'll see you in, you know, a year for your physical. No, they say, I want you to come back in a month. I want you to come back in 6 months. I want you to have another checkup. So we do the same thing. We have our treatment plan. We do our experiments. We make some changes. We evaluate them. Come back 6 months, see if it was the right thing to do. You know, are the benches in the right place? Where do we put the path? Is that traffic circle reconfiguration working? And then we make it permanent. So it's very much an incremental approach, and it's very much done in a holistic way in partnership with our communities to see what the outcomes are and then to make adjustments. But it's very important to realize that the decisions that you make today affect the place and the outcomes for years to come. So the decisions made today have a tremendous impact going forward. How many of you remember Hurricane Agnes, 1973, I think it was? Susquehanna River flooded. We love you all, 1972. Susquehanna, this is Elmira and Corning, New York. I grew up in Baltimore, Maryland. We had flooding. The Susquehanna was just flooding everywhere. It was like my first hurricane. And the response to these two communities, almost 50 years ago, has shaped how these two communities have continued to evolve. not pushing the right button. Okay. So here we are, flash forward. Elmira's on the left, Corning is on the right. These are two cities. They're, you know, upstate. They're not too far away from here. They're a little far. They're closer to the actual Cornell. They're near Ithaca. They are about 20 minutes apart. And the problem with Elmira was they couldn't attract people, and they thought that if they wanted to get a new business in, the only way to get a new business in was to tear down the building next door to bring parking for that new business, because without the parking, that new business would not survive. Corning is like, we think the businesses are important and people will find a place to put their cars. So they went two different directions. This idea was that after Agnes, Elmira said, this will never happen again. The Army Corps of Engineers came in and they said, we've actually done webinars for FEMA and their community development specialists. They said, okay, we have money, Elmira, what do you want to do? They say, build us a wall. We do not want that river ever to flood again. So when you are in Elmira, New York, you never get a glimpse of the Susquehanna River, ever. They came to Corning. They go, okay, I guess you guys want a wall too. Corning is like, hell no. We don't want a wall. Can we use that money to rebuild our main street? And the Army Corps says, well, no one's ever asked us before. And they go, sure, yeah, why not? So if the Army Corps ever comes in, you can give them a list of things you want them to spend money on. So they go, yeah, but aren't you afraid of flooding again? And Corning says, well, you're giving us money now to rebuild our main street. They're like, yeah, so if our main street floods again, yeah, you'll give us money to rebuild it again, right? They're like, yeah, they go, what the hell, sure. So Corning rebuilt their main street. And here there are main streets side by side. But the whole philosophy, and I think, am I moving my slides or are you moving my slides? You are. Can we go back? And I'll just say next. Is that a good idea? Okay, let's go back. So the idea is that to this day, okay, next. Elmira is designing for cars and parking, and Corning is designing for people and places. And here you see the main street in Elmira and the main street in Corning. And you have this one lonely, very brave person trying to ride their bike. So cars and traffic, if you plan for cars and traffic, you get cars and traffic. And if you plan for people and places, you get people and places. So this is a critical moment, I think, in a lot of communities, is to basically decide how much traffic you want to accommodate and how you want to accommodate people that are not just driving into your community. Next. So here we have the Mark Twain Theater on the left in Elmira, and it looks like a fur storage garage, like where my bubby would take her furs to put, you know, in the summertime when she wasn't using it. It's a beautiful theater on a state highway with truck traffic. There are little dance companies. I once saw these, like a troop of about 15 7-year-olds in tutus with their moms running across the state highway into the theater because they had to park across the street. In downtown Corning, they have the Corning Museum. They have Glassworks. This is a radio station. It's all on the ground floor. Next. A parking garage in Elmira on the left and a parking garage in Corning on the right. Donald Shoup is a wonderful author and thinker and educator who wrote The High Cost of Free Parking. And Donald Shoup, S-H-O-U-P, it has proven that the top floor of any parking garage anywhere in America is always empty. This garage on the left is about 6 stories. It costs $1 to park there and no one uses it, because like most parking garages, it is dark, it is dirty, it feels unsafe, and charging $1 for parking does not pay for this facility. Structured parking costs about $40,000 a space. Underground parking is about $50,000 a space. And every parking spot that you have that you allow for free parking in your towns costs $10,000. Parking is not free. Parking is a utility, parking should be metered, managed, and parking should generate income for the communities when and where it makes sense. But even you can do parking attractively. So the parking garage on the right there, it's really screened, it doesn't look particularly unattractive, and it is actually walking distance to the downtown. So this diagram shows the parking in Elmira, because they said they needed more parking, otherwise no one would come. The real shortage is they have no places for people to go, not places to park. It is suffering from an excess of parking between surface lots. Can you go to the next one? Surface lots, parking structures are blue, surface lots are red, and all the on-street parking. All of this parking has eradicated the very reason people went there in the first place. No one goes anywhere because it has great parking. Oh, Elmira, there's nothing to do, but wow, what a great place to park the car. You know, they go to Corning because it's such a great place, and they park remotely to get there. I'll show you the next slide. So here's that parking garage in Corning, and it's back there behind the clock tower. So, and over here on the left, you can see it. The walk from the parking garage to the main street is a critical 100 yards. It's a critical distance. And we saw that in Monticello. It is like the make or break distance. So when you park in Corning, you just walk through this plaza. Already there's a cafe, there's seating, and then the main street is right in front. You can see the main street from the parking. That's also true in Monticello, but that walk is seamless. And you feel that by the time you've parked your car, you're already having the experience you came them to have. There's not a disconnect between getting out of my car and walking to Soy for dinner. It's like, I've parked, I'm already here. And that's that kind of blended experience that you want. We'll go to the next. Okay, so above all, the community is the expert. So we start our diagnosis by asking the patient how they're feeling and what is wrong with them. Professionals are usually seen to be the expert, or the physician is the expert, but the physician is not the expert on your own health. You are, the community are, you are, you know your problems and you know how you're supposed to feel. The professional's role is to draw that expertise from the community and be a resource. So this is how we do our, we take our medical history and asking the patient how they feel. Go to the next one. So who are the people that we talk to? Government, health sector, researchers, developers, business, schools, professionals, hospitals, healthcares, all of these diverse groups. I know you work with a lot of partners, and I want you to think about unlikely partners as well as likely partners. Next. So we engage the community through a variety of different activities. Workshops should be fun. And yesterday we did a little talking, we did a little walking, we were in the snow, got a little cold, we came in, we had coffee, and we discussed. So getting people up and out. Go to where people are. People will not always have the time or the energy or the vehicle or the childcare to be able to take a car, go downtown to town hall on a Tuesday night at 7 for a meeting. They just can't do it. But we go to where people are. We set up tables outside of a Catholic church in Los Angeles County on a Sunday. We go to the MLK celebration in Bedford-Stuyvesant in Brooklyn. We go to a night market in Camden, New Jersey. We go to where people are to get their input. Let's go to the next. And here are just some examples of those. These sort of dot preference surveys. If you go to the next slide, please. We call this dotmocracy. So this is where you've actually gotten some ideas and images of what people want at a workshop, and they go, okay, wintertime, they want an ice skating rink, they want a winter market, and they want sort of outdoor fire pits. Well, we don't really have a lot of money for all of those things. We don't know what folks want, so we put the boards up, and we go, okay, put a dot on what you want, and everyone puts like a dot on, they want an ice skating rink. You know, or they really want a Christmas market, and then if you're lucky, the city councilor comes by and puts dots on everything and says, I think we want everything and I will get us money for that. But we call this dotmocracy because every dot is equal. Every dot has an equal voice. And what's nice about this, and you'll see in the next shot as well, is that when people are giving their priority, you've heard of visual preference survey maybe, this is sort of like that, but the physical act of putting a dot on what you want and your vote counts, and then we count those dots up, and it's easy to count them up, and the community then starts to prioritize what it is they want to do first. What is the low-hanging fruit? We have $10,000 or $50,000. What do people want to see first? this is how you find out. And there's a lot of conversation and discussion that happens as well. Next. But when you're doing, whenever you're having a meeting, you're always bringing the images back to get more input. So you've got one set of ideas about what people want to see in a place. And we also use pictures and flip charts about things that they want to do in that space. So it's kind of an iterative process. You get one group together, you get their ideas, you take it out to another group, you get their feedback, then you bring it to like another event. You're just trying to make sure you're vetting the ideas and that those great ideas keep coming to the top. You want those top five ideas that everyone is talking about. So that's sort of how the process works. It goes through a few iterations. Next. You've probably seen this. Candy Chang, the public artist, started doing this. You know, before I die, I want XYZ, and people sort of do this board. This was a project we did in Houston, Mississippi for a trail project, and we worked with the Mississippi State University planning students, and it says, this place needs, and this was about connecting a trail to a downtown. This place needs bike racks, a restaurant, a map, a directory, a water fountain, a small park. It needs sidewalks, a pavilion, bike lanes. You take a picture, you erase it, you put it back out. You know, this could be next to the post office or the supermarket or the library. You've seen this. You can actually make these chalkboards with just chalk paint. Next. Another tool that we use is community asset mapping, where we start looking at a whole map. We were looking at some fabulous maps yesterday, putting dots on where the assets are, those community anchors, those important destinations, the fabulous bakery that everybody loves. What are those assets? Next. And then we look at, well, how do we connect them? Because oftentimes, these places just kind of exist on their own, or there's physical barriers, or there's, you know, there's a healthy farmer's market, and there's a senior center, but the senior center doesn't buy the food from the market for the on market days, because when there's a Wednesday market, farmer's market, that should be market day at the senior center, and they should be sourcing all their food from the market to bring to the seniors. So these missing connections that people are really good at identifying. Next. We often ask people also, what are the worst places? And the places with potential. Because again, you want to know what's really working well. What are the really fabulous places? And then why are they working so well? And what lessons can we learn from those fabulous places to make those places with potential improve? And then once you do that, how do we then impact the really most challenging spots? You never start with the hardest place or the hardest project or the most difficult thing. If you start with a zero and you get it to a four, but if you start with a four and you get it to an eight, people really notice. So the idea is to start with your assets, learn from the really good ones, and even a great place can be made better. But then try to get something that was kind of okay and really turn it upside down. If you've got a great bakery, think about how we could do outdoor seating, or how we could actually put a window in so people can see the baking happening, or how there can be baking classes for people in the neighborhood or the community. Just how that whole thing can kind of exponentially build on itself. And we call that the power of 10. And I'll be talking about that in a minute as well. All right, I'm going to try to pick up the pace here a little bit. Connectivity, so we do these mapping exercises where people are drawing things. Next, we did this in Houston, Mississippi with this trail, identifying the assets along the trail. The idea was they built a trail. They go, great, economic development, wahoo, we're going to get $40 million. And this was a 40-mile trail, and it was connected actually not far from the Natchez Trace. They go, great, where are all the people? I'm ready to open my B&B. Where are all the people? There were no maps. There was no connection from the trail to Main Street because they forgot. They forgot that people on this 40 don't know that downtown Houston's over there, and there's a B&B, and there's a Dominican restaurant. There was just this disconnect between Main Street and the chamber and the trail. They just magically thought the spandex crowd would find them. So we had to identify sort of how do we connect, and not even the spandex crowd. We wanted people in that community to use the trail. Tourists are great. We're all tourists. We're all visitors. When you make a place that's fabulous for the community, that serves the residents, that increases their health and their mobility, that connects them to destinations, if you serve the residents first, the tourists will find you. If you go for the tourists first, they decide they want to go back to Boca, and they're done, and you never see them again. Tourists are very fickle. Restaurants are hot, restaurants are cold. Residents are forever. So we always think about sustainable tourism. It's really about making the place fabulous for the people that live there, making those trailheads, community gathering spaces, and then the tourists will see, hey, it's movie night, and they're playing Frozen, and we can bike on the trail from our B&B and watch the movie with everyone else from town. So that I just had to get that out there. Next. So then we, oh, go back one more thing. So then it was looking at really connecting not just the trail to downtown, but also finding the safest way to get to the Natchez Trace. The Natchez Trace is 444-mile parkway that connects to Natchez, Mississippi, and it's just, it's a beautiful, beautiful greenway, and they didn't want to go on Route 8 because it's a truck route, so we found this little road. We did our mapping together. Next. Then we also figured out how do we get the bikes on there, where are the bike lanes going, because we don't want bikes on every single road. They shouldn't be on truck roads. There's alternative routes through town. And then we said, well, hey, the next thing we came up with was look at what's happening downtown. So let's do a historic loop. Next, please. And get the bikes not just on this trail for 40 miles, but going around our historic trail and our historic downtown. And connecting and letting them see, you know, that there are places in the Natchez Trace that were here. And there's old Native American trails. And there's even, like, bison moved here. All the history of the town. And then next, the next layer was, well, what about safe routes to school? We've got opportunities for kids to walk now that we've got bikes and trails. So we came up with a safe routes to school map as well. So we went from this big picture of how do we connect to this huge, you know, wonderful tourist thing to how do we get people around our town, and then how do we get our kids walking to school. So we kind of layered it down in that way. Next, we did this the other day. We have copies of this audit where you go out and you evaluate how a place is working. Next, and then also looking at, next slide please, the outcomes of that, which are a lot of drawings, designs. This is how we start our conceptual mapping and our conceptual planning in terms of taking these ideas from the community and then starting to do some design work. So we diagnose according to the four quadrants of place, and we come up with a vision for what can happen there. So this is sort of a diagram of a place vision, where you have this site and you have all the things that people want together. We're always about co-locating things together. So you have a playground next to the farmer's market with the outdoor fitness class and a complete street and a garden, and flexible seating, exercise, healthy meal classes, dance nights. We're thinking about how do you activate a public space from about 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. or 6 a.m. to midnight, and how do you keep it active 6 months of the year, 10 months of the year, 8 months of the year, but it's about collecting things together. There's nothing like go to the next slide, please, going to a playground, and you see a playground, and it's in the sun, and the kids are playing. And there's no benches, and there's no water, and there's no bathroom. Kids do nothing if not pee. And nowhere to eat, and nowhere to hook the dog, and mom and dad or the caregivers are standing there watching the kids, and then they're ready to go in 20 minutes. Or you have like 4-year-old, 8-year-olds, but you've got 12-year-olds or 6-year-olds, and that playground only really fits one age group, so then you have a parent who's running between playgrounds, different sides of the park. We never really think about designing playgrounds for the parents or the families, and it's how you sort of look at connecting all these things together. And part of the problem, next, is that no one sees the big picture. So if you were actually trying to figure out what an elephant is and you had blinders on, you wouldn't know if it was a spear, a snake, a tree, or a wall. And this is sort of how our city governments work, county governments, state governments, federal governments, global governments. Everyone is in a silo and everyone is diagnosing the problem from their own silo, from their own perspective. And that's why we have the problems that we do. So what placemaking does is it brings all these people together in their same room at the same time to come up with the vision for the place. Next. So this is our place diagram, and we have this on our website, pps.org. But great places, think about wonderful places that you've been to. You will notice that they have activities going on, they're comfortable to be in, they're accessible and connected, and there's a lot of other people using them. So access and linkages, let's go to the next one. I don't have this. Next, please. So these are, they're walkable, they're connected. Gateways are really a lot of fun. This was sort of for our Tanglefoot Trail, looking at these highway overpasses and railroad trestles, and how, in fact, those spaces can be used as welcoming gateways. And I live in Hoboken, New Jersey during the week, and that is what we have at Hoboken when you come into town. But thinking about making those overhead highway trestles, railroad trestles, gateway welcoming features. Next. Really going crazy and just sort of showcasing the heck out of your local culture, like they do in British Columbia. Duncan, City of Totems. You go to Duncan, you go to, you know, this is north of Vancouver, near Victoria, there's totem poles everywhere. So what is, I was working in Walton many years ago with actually Helen Budrock from Sullivan Renaissance, and Walton, New York, in Delaware County, is the scarecrow capital of the world. And I said, well, we have a festival. And I said, why do you just have a festival? Why don't you just have scarecrows up everywhere all the time? And why don't artists create scarecrows and kids create scarecrows? And why don't you just own that and celebrate it and make that your sort of insignia? Next, you can use, you know, this is in Jacksonville, Wyoming, where they collect all the antlers and then they light them up at night. So this could be at a gateway to a park in front of a commercial building downtown, but really, again, tapping into those local sort of contextual elements. Next, we looked in Kanyanga Lake yesterday, and we were looking at that intersection of 55 and 17, and really thinking about making that perhaps a roundabout, or not a traffic circle. Traffic circles are signalized, but a roundabout, because that is really the heart of that community. That's really the gateway and the meeting place and the gathering place, and it's incredibly unsafe for everybody, especially if you're on foot or a bicycle or not, you know, not adult and physically abled. So that is something where the Department of Transportation needs to come, and you need to take them there with my 80-year-old mother in a wheelchair and someone's grandchild and hold them by the hand and try to get across that street. We do that with traffic engineers. It's really, it's a challenge and it's a major opportunity. And if you can transform that, then Kanyanga Lake will be heading in the right direction. But how that's treated is critical at this point. Next, but you could actually do something maybe temporarily. This was a Girl Scout project in Portland, Oregon, and a Girl Scout who probably would have gotten a Sullivan Renaissance Award if she'd been here today, did this for her civics badge. She wanted her little brother to be able to play in the ground and walk to school. So she asked if she could paint the intersections in her neighborhood, and she was given, I guess, permission by the local police, and they did this as a community project. This is now City of Portland policy, that anyone in a neighborhood has the right and the permission to paint their intersection as a traffic calming and neighborhood identifier technique. It doesn't slow the traffic. It doesn't make the trucks go boom, boom. It doesn't slow the fire engines down or the ambulance, but it gives drivers a sense and information that they need to slow down because they're entering a neighborhood where this Girl Scout's 8-year-old brother is walking to school. Next, temporary crosswalks. We could try this in Monticello, maybe in the parking lot. These are just like little concrete curbs with carnations in pots and a painted crosswalk. There's a temporary curbing with flowers on it. You can experiment with some of these curbings and changing the way, making it safe for pedestrians to walk. Next, signage is very important because you need different signs at different part of your experience, and there are people that do great signage and wayfinding, and it's a whole system. So to do that, you want it from the state road to the county road or the exit off of 17 into your main street, to the parking. to the downtown businesses and at the pedestrian level and the motorist level and the bicycle level. So think about a system of signs. Next, and signs can also be indicative of your community. The one on the left is in a garden, and it looks like, it's a little hard to see, but it's made of it's metal, but it's shaped like a vine. Next, thinking about trails and paths along, like how can you walk along Kaneanga Lake? I know it's all private, but is there somewhere walking paths along these beautiful natural resources are important. Next, we also talked about artist design bicycles and bicycle racks, putting in the no parking spaces, putting in bike racks so that people, you can park more bikes, you can park about 12 bicycles in one parking space, but making parking for bikes a priority over parking for cars. Next, and also looking at accessibility for people of all ages and all abilities. That's like the stroller parking lot. Next slide. And you can do this. I know that Mark Fenton showed this last year, but it's that idea that when you do park your car, signage like this reassures you you can get to your destination on foot. And it says it's going to take you 17 minutes to walk to that station, but it's 7 minutes to the cemetery, or it's 5 minutes to downtown. Or you park your car, behind the county building in Monticello, it is a 2-minute walk to Broadway. These are just these reassurances to pedestrians once you leave the safety of your vehicle that you're going to be able to get to your destination on time. Next, please. So the next is uses and activities. Programming is incredibly important, and what we find is a lot of public spaces are designed and they're built and then people walk away and they're supposed to just become lively and wonderful. They will not survive without programming. Programming is actually more important than design. Next, so markets, thinking about how you build on markets as attracting visitors. This is a market next to a train station. Next, I don't know if you do outdoor movie nights. Okay, everyone should do an outdoor movie night. These screens are like $2,000, $4,000. It doesn't cost you much to actually rent the film. People love outdoor movies. They're really a lot of fun. Next, outdoor performances, and this is an opportunity for young people and the high school battles of the band and younger musicians and performers to celebrate and become part of the community because they like to be downtown too. Next, exercise, again, you're walking along a trail but having another kind of experience of exercise and health. Next slide. We're talking about sand volleyball in the parking lot in Monticello. Yay, beach volleyball. What's nice about sand is then you can put the ice skating rink on top of it. So we like to think, it's sand and volleyball in the summertime and it's ice skating in the wintertime. Next, but even looking at some of these like blank buildings and sides of buildings, could you turn something into a climbing wall? Might you want to have a temporary skateboard ramp, in your community? Next slide. Games are back. Everyone loves to play games in public spaces. Ping pong, Jenga, pickup sticks, everything is now 3 or 4 feet high. Next, chess, checkers, and parks as well. So thinking about games, people just have the boards there and the pieces. Somebody has to manage that. Next slide, and the dancing activities that are kind of fun. They do this a lot, in cities they have tango classes, ballroom dancing classes, contra dancing as well. But dancing in your public spaces, again, not a lot of money, but programming, someone, the dance club or the tango teacher says, hi, can I use this space? And then the space has to have the amenities to allow tango to happen. Next slide, thinking about, winter happens, so highlighting the seasons and the programs. The slide on the right is an art project in Calgary, which is about as cold today, every day in the winter, as it is now. It's giant, it's made up of light bulbs, and everyone comes in at dusk when the place is pretty empty and turns on the lights. It's kind of an interactive art show. Next slide, it's combining but ice skating with a market, with food, with entertainment as well. Next, and then they do a lot of, next slide, they do a lot of wonderful work in Providence, on the Providence River, but next slide, please, with actually using the water as an art canvas. And they have these, this is in Houston, they have these floating light tulips. They do river fire in Providence, down the Providence River. they have the gold duck, the giant, you know, the duckling races, but thinking about how you can actually use the water bodies as venues for art and culture. And this is one of my favorite projects, the laundromat project. Even a laundromat can be turned into a place for cultural arts, cultural education, and activities. This is where the artists, they have an artist in residence program in the laundromat, so some artists paint them. Other artists do programs with kids outside of the laundromat. And the upper left is actually a cooking demonstration that is happening in a laundromat. There's also yoga, because doing your laundry, it's going to the well, washing, doing your laundry is like a mind-numbing experience. And for people that can't afford their own washer dryer, this is what they do every couple of weeks. So how do you make those mundane, you know, activities of daily living an experience for building community and making art? So the next part of our sort of vision is comfort and image, safe and walkable. Next slide. I think Mark Fenton talked about this last year, about amenities are not amenities. They're functional requirements of a space. They're actually not just add-ons. But basically, to create a lively, comfortable space, you need weather protection, a place to sit, access to food and water, something to do and something to look at. So how do you create these wonderful amenities that make it comfortable for people to be in a space? This is in Buffalo, Canal Side, movable furniture, Adirondack chairs as well. The next slide shows beanbag chairs, which are all the rage. They're coming back. If you still have beanbag chairs, bring them out of your homes. Next is looking at how flowers and banners can actually help people circulate and move through your community, so the plantings and the flowers and the beautification projects can be part of that wayfinding and signage and circulation. You look for the flowers, you know that's your next destination. So marking those nodes, marking those community assets with beautification as a way of being breadcrumbs, leading people through a community. Next, there's like art, and also illumination is a very, this was like a temporary art project. You jump on the art, on the little donuts or bagels, and they light up. The next slide shows, this was sort of a storage, they needed a storage facility in this park. And we said, well, what if we create an imagination station where we have education and literacy classes and poetry readings that has storage in the back? So when you have amenities, you're going to need someone to put them out, bring them back in, and a place to keep them. And the next slide shows food trucks as a way of starting food entrepreneurs, supporting local entrepreneurs, helping people go from perhaps a culinary commercial kitchen to a business before they become bricks and mortar. And also providing food service where people are, if there is no food service available, because people like to have access to food. Next slide, sociability. And there's the slide after that is showing the kids in Boston Common, and they're on the ugly duckling, and they know all the ducks by name. Next slide, please. They know them all by name, and the idea is to show how our cities can be multi-generational, intergenerational. Next slide, please. Where this little kid is testing out the bench, you know, he's probably 8 and he's sitting with the 80-year-olds and he's gonna see, maybe he's gonna end up there one day. We talk a lot about age-friendly cities and aging in place, but we're talking more about cities for a lifetime, a place where you wanna grow up, a place that, you want to come back to after college, a place where you want to be able to rent or buy a home to start a family, and a place where you want to retire when you want to downsize. You can live your entire life cycle in the same community because there's housing and services to support that. So it's not just aging in place where you are, being able to stay in your home, but it's basically being able to stay and afford to be able to live in your community throughout your lifetime. Next, this is a beach that we worked with Southwest Airlines to build in downtown Detroit, which is a place for a tremendous civil interaction, social cohesion. People love the beach, and you get every demographic, every social economic background. Everybody from Detroit loves to come to the beach. So these great public spaces provide opportunities for people from the community, all aspects, everyone from the community, to feel welcomed, to have a right to the city, and to participate in the life of that city. Next slide. And I just would love to hear what these people, what these guys have come up with to play. When you have these pianos and you have one piano, someone, you'll see them, you've seen them, I'm yours, play me. When you have two together, there has to be a conversation. Are we doing a duet? Are we doing battles of the pianos? Are we playing Chopin? Are we, you know, are we playing Billy Child? Like, who are we playing here? I would just love to hear that music. Again, these opportunities for people who are different from each other, who are part of the same community, to come together and share an experience together in a public space. Next, and we also talk about, you know, this is in Camden, New Jersey, at night, very dangerous neighborhood, this huge communal supper and these pancake breakfasts. But they take over the street. They take over the road. They do it in the, why don't they do it in the road? They do in these places. Okay. The next slide is sort of our framing. So how do you take this from like a smaller place to a destination, to a city or a region? This is part of our sort of our treatment plan. This is looking at all of the assets and how we connect them together. I really wish I had access to this clicker because I'd be going through it a lot faster than I am. This is Littleton, New Hampshire. I'm just, next slide, and this was their vision to eat in diners, ride a train, put a porch on your house, shop on Main Street, live in a walkable community. This is their downtown, and they had a city hall. They have an opera house, next slide. They have a lot of locally owned and operated businesses that they're very proud of. Next slide, they have a movie theater, which is great. Next, they have a post office, and they have a visitor center in this park. They have a library that they're very fond of. They have some retail, very cute little community as well. And then next slide, that hotel is where all the candidates stay in New Hampshire for the primaries. And that Portofino's Market is where everyone from Massachusetts drives up to get their tax-free cigarettes and eat deli sandwiches. And if you look, the next slide shows you all these dots. So these are the power of 10 dots. And I think this, a lot of your communities have this. They have these great little destinations that are sort of spread out behind town. And part of what we were trying to do, next slide, is connect the dots together. And more importantly, connect over the bridge, next slide, and then connect to the vast amounts of parking located behind Main Street, where no one was parking. So that was sort of our goal here. Next, this is. So what we tried to do was look at the street in terms of designing the street and the parking and the connections based on the uses that were there, based on who was actually, what were the businesses there, and how are they being used. Can you hear me if I talk on this? Is this on? Okay, great. So looking at how you configure the street based on the businesses. So if you have a post office. Post office people run in, they run out, they're there for 10 minutes. You don't need 2-hour parking. Diagonal parking is perfect. A restaurant, you want 2-hour parking because you want people to actually have a meal there. So looking at how you actually design and time and charge for the parking based on the people using it and how long they're going to be in that space. So that was sort of our goal here. And where to put crosswalks is how are people crossing the street from one destination to another. So if you push the next slide, you'll see kind of how we, can you go back? It didn't animate. Okay. So it's basically place by place by place. We looked at where the crosswalks go, what kind of different parking to have, where people wanted to park, and how to actually turn those places inside out. So it's very much of a place by place sort of parking and street redesign initiative. But how many of you have a bridge over a body of water leading into your town? So this is an off-the-rack bridge leading into Littleton, New Hampshire. And it's a truck route, of course, and a highway. And you kind of look at it and go, okay, I'm just going to go through this town and make a left. So this was another gateway opportunity. And just by some lighter, quicker, cheaper, actually Sullivan Renaissance kinds of treatments, we could transform this into a really beautiful gateway. So this is just a photo sim. But the idea was to put out flowers and planters, to remove the grass by that restaurant, to restore these historic buildings to their original true colors, put out some banners and some seating. Now this, coming into this bridge, you would feel very different about that community. It might be a place that you want to stop. So when we're talking about beautification and flowers, I'm really trying to get you to think as you are. I totally love the direction that you're going into these more collaborations, but thinking about how combining these things together, the seating, the food, the flowers, the banners, the information, the heritage preservation, you can actually transform how your communities look. So stepping back a little bit farther, going into town, we had ideas for how to bring those businesses closer to the street. So the next slide shows we put in a bike lane, we put in banners, we put the signage closer to the street, and again, gave people an idea and a hint that they were coming into a really special community. So I don't know if you guys get into banners, but banners are really quite a wonderful thing. We looked around the town also and said, well, how can we make some of these smaller connections happen more easily? So this is a very favorite ice cream place in Littleton, New Hampshire, and it's next to a bank. Next slide, please. And if you see it, basically I'm standing in the neighborhood and I've got like a two-lane road going from my neighborhood to the bank and the ice cream parlor. So people were not walking there and it was very walkable. So the idea was to put in a crosswalk so people from the neighborhood, the kids, could walk to ice cream, and then taking down the fence, no one knew why it was there, between the bank and the ice cream parlor so that you could actually do both things. So creating this triangulation, very small scale changes, working with a number of partners at the same time. So we have then our short-term experiments, and we have our treatment plan, and we always evaluate how we're doing and what we're doing and how we can make it better. So why do we talk about lighter, quicker, cheaper? And this is a phrase you may totally rip off and duplicate. It's a good thing to do. People spend a lot of time planning. They spend a lot of time talking and meeting. And as we know, then sometimes nothing happens. So that's another reason why Sullivan Renaissance and all of the volunteers are so amazing, because you show progress that things can happen. But it's a way of sparking creativity, getting people out and doing things right away, and building more momentum. So this is sort of how we do it. We create these mini destinations. We can right-size your street. You sort of support walking and biking, but really looking at your assets. It's very much a ground up, and it may start with a one-day event or an event that, like a farmer's market, or a farmer's market that happens every month, and then maybe bringing in some food trucks and amenities. So you're always, it's very much an incremental process of building on your strengths and doing what you have with the money that you have when you have it, because we always say that don't chase the money. Find the partners, find the other zealous nuts, create a fabulous, wonderful vision together, and then the money will find you. Not too far from here, this is what Wallkill Library was doing. They were doing placemaking at their library. Next slide. And basically, just to let people know they could sit on the grass, because they've got a book, but they don't think they can sit outside. Something very simple is saying, please sit on the grass. And they had a movie night, and they had picnics and music. Next slide. And it was very incremental. They had about $5,000, and they just sort of put a new face on their library. And libraries are really amazing, because they're the last free, open, democratic space in many of our communities. Everyone is welcome in the library. Everyone has a right to be there. And libraries are so much more than about books. They're really about community. In this project in Corbin, Kentucky, a farmer's market basically spurred the entire revitalization of downtown Corbin. Next. So they started with the petunias, or native perennials. So they did very much like what you were doing in terms of beautification. Next, they also then did lighting of their businesses. They did some wonderful lighting of local stores and shops. Next. They have a moonbow. They have the only naturally occurring nighttime rainbow. It happens over a river like once a year, so they have a moonbow celebration. They started a 5K in Corbin, Kentucky. They did these temporary bump outs and parklet seating areas. They started a trolley, then they put in a bike route, and some of the businesses from the market moved into become brick and mortar stores. in Corbin, Kentucky. And it's quite, you can look at it online, it's quite an incremental. This is really super incremental. Hallam, Nebraska, outside of Lincoln, 894 people, the little town with the big heart, they had about $1,500 and they did all this crazy stuff for their Hallam Day. Next. They did a little plan. You always have to have a little plan, a little diagram. How are things going to fit together? Next slide. So this was their project. This was their plan to improve Main Street for a weekend. Street art, benches, planners, and banners. They had the heart, a little heart. They painted hearts in their intersections next to the crossroads. They did their own bump outs, burlap, mulch, and trees in pots. Next slide. Here they are doing it. Next slide. And they did these little benches with 2x4s. That those chess pieces, they're like joint compound lids that are painted red and blue to make chess really lighter, quicker, cheaper, food, fun, and shade. Next slide. And of course, what do you want to see next? Because once you have a vision, you want to keep going and figuring out what else people want to do. I'm just going to go through these. I'm going to actually skip this section, I think. I know that Mark talked a lot about right-sizing streets. So if we could just kind of go through these, I'm not going to. We have our right-sizing streets on our webpage, pps.org. If we could just kind of scroll through these quickly. I don't have my, hello? I'm having some technical okay, all right. Can you go back, okay? Go back a little more. I did want to show you, okay, next. Okay, I wanted to show you these slides of parking lots because I know you have a lot of parking lots in terms of what you can do quickly and cheaply with paint and chairs. This has also brought in a lot of new businesses. Next slide. So there was before and after. So these are also temporary. You can do things with chalk. You can do things with adhesive as well. Next slide. But they put a little lending library in it. It wasn't just seating and it wasn't just food. It was that next layer of a civic institution, the library, doing a lending library. Next. Big project. This is a big parking lot in Milwaukee. They decided this was the heart of their community. We work with a lot of very creative people in Milwaukee to turn this into the spot, to turn this into a place, basically with paint, some furnishings like picnic tables, a food truck, and a lot of programming. And this is what can happen over the course of a summer with a lot of volunteers. So a larger space next, but also games, you know. But everything was chalk, everything was paint, and everything was the idea that it would become either a development site, but just a place for the community to come out. So turning that parking lot into the heart and soul of their community. And even to have outdoor, the way to have outdoor fire like this, to have braziers, or marshmallows, is to actually get the firemen, the fire department, to light these for you and watch over them. And then the firemen get more involved in your community. That's one way to get fire. We can just look at these really quickly, but thinking about how you use shoulders along the side of the road for outdoor seating, temporary decking as a way of providing more sidewalk space. But that space, that roadway space, is public space. 80% of the public space in any city or town are streets and roads. So how do we reclaim that for people, for sitting, for shopping, for dining, for socializing? Next. These are just a couple slides about retail. Renew Australia, a project to provide the liability and the umbrella insurance for a lot of art entrepreneurs to take over vacant space in Newcastle, Australia, to incubate new businesses and revitalize the downtown. Next. So here are some of their art examples and activities. Next slide. And he's, you know, Marcus Westerberry is very much about looking and talking to the property owners because they do own a lot of land. And you have to use your liabilities as opportunities. So if there's an organization or a nonprofit, that's the umbrella between the artist or the and the property owner. You can actually make use of those spaces much more effectively. This is Gabriel's Wharf in London. These were all blank walls. Again, a little bit like Monticello in the back of their parking lot. Next. Those are all facades, blank walls, painted facades, with some shallow retail vendors, but creating like a high street and a village look on the back side of the buildings facing where you want people to park to make it look like it's another main street. They've got market, they've got performance, they generate income. Didn't cost a lot to do. It's had a very transformational impact. All right, this, I recommend Rick Hauser as your keynote for next year. I'm already like replacing myself. How many of you know Rick Hauser, mayor of Perry, New York? Ah, we'll love him. Rick is an architect. He moved to town. He wanted to set up an architecture practice. He looked at this fabulous building. He went, couldn't find who owned it, couldn't find a phone number, finally found who owned it, called the guy up and says, I want to rent your space. It says for rent. And he goes, I don't want to rent it to you. He goes, why don't you want to rent it to me? He says, because I'm gonna charge you $500 a month for rent. Why should I fix up my building when you're going to move out in 6 months? So Rick sort of started to unwrap this circle of dysfunction between vacant space, vacant buildings, buildings that were actually up to code, that were usable, why landlords wouldn't invest in them to bring them up to code to find tenants because they didn't think the tenants were going to make it worth their while. So he started his own Main Street LLC, and he has since purchased a number of buildings and renovated them because he says, if you don't invest in your town, don't expect anyone else to. Put your money where your house is. He goes door to door, and he asks people, he goes, how much money can give me as much as you can afford not to see for 5 years? And I'm going to buy a building, and we're going to get that bakery that you want, and we're going to get that bookstore, and we're going to find that spa. We're not going to wait, oh, I wish that beautiful old firehouse would become a spa. And then it's, you know, rented and turned into an Airstream trailer repair facility, which is what happened in Lima, New York. So he will then collect money from the community. It's like, invest in Main Street, don't invest in Wall Street. And he'll buy the buildings, renovate them, bring in the tenants, come back to them and go, here's your money back. And they go, great, what are we buying now? So he has bought up and renovated a number of buildings, as well as a school that is now becoming an art center. And he's doing it with the assets and the resources of the people in the community. Some people give him $500, some give him $5,000, some give him $50,000. And that's sort of how he works. So Rick Hauser, Perry, New York, I'm sure he would love to come here, and I'm sure you'd love to meet him. So as you know, we can't do it alone, because everyone in this room is a partner and is collaborating with everyone else. These are the movements. These are the different partners that you may think about. Transportation is huge. Historic preservation, we're doing a lot of work with the National Main Street Center. Food systems, farms, farmers, CSAs, public health, because all of your communities have all of these assets. They have all of these wonderful things working together, but they don't necessarily gel. They're not necessarily connected physically, visually, or programmatically. And these public spaces can be the way to connect the dots together. And you don't have to start big. You don't have to start with an arena. I know you're getting a casino. What are 10 things you can do around a casino? Think about that. You don't have to start. You can start with a bus stop, a main street, a park, a plaza. Build on your markets. Your libraries are amazing, amazing. Your hospitals can be community centers as well. Schools, religious institutions. So you can start small, but link things together. So this is a very quick project from where I live on the weekends, which is just over the mountains in the town of Olive, which it's between Phoenicia and Woodstock, just over the mountains. Next to us, the Leaping Trout Project, which combines art, retail, economic development, wayfinding, riparian awareness, and water quality, and building the next generation of trout fishermen. So it's not just about, oh, we want to save the water, we want to improve the water, we want more people to fish. It combines the art. The artists do the trouts go in the stores, there's a map to the stores, people shop in the stores, and they get information about riparian awareness, if you have a creekside property, how you can take care of your creek and your river, and why trout fishing is the absolute best sport known to humankind. But combining all these things together, layering them, you know, art, economic development, environment, water quality, outdoor education, outdoor exercise and healthy living, always building, trying to find everything should do 10 things. These are some resources for you. Denise talked about the Citizens Institute on Rural Design. LISC, Rural LISC, has amazing, amazing information, great funding sources for local, for smaller communities. How many of you are realtors? How many of you are, like, members of the National Association of Realtors? This lady, you need to talk to them. There is a wonderful Smart Growth Award the National Association of Realtors offers. It's buried on their website. It's anywhere between $2,500, $5,000, or $15,000 to make communities wonderful and walkable and livable so that realtors can sell homes. It's genius. So a realtor and a community group will put in an application together, and it's a rolling funding program, and the funds go to making wonderful, livable, walkable main streets that we all want our communities to be and people want to live in. So that's a really unknown, I believe, resource. And this is how you can find us and follow PPS. We have a newsletter, we have trainings, we do blog posts, and we would love to see you all again. Thank you very much, and thank you for your time.
Thank you, Cynthia. How's everybody doing? Good? You're hanging in there? All right. I am lucky enough to be the person that stands between you and lunch and the bathroom, so I'm going to try to make it really quick, I promise. Okay. So last year, Sullivan Renaissance announced the creation of a new grant program designed to encourage municipalities to work in partnership with volunteers to address issues relating to beautification, code enforcement, and healthy communities. I'm happy to announce that after a rigorous review, the following five municipalities have been selected this year to participate in our Municipal Partnership Grant Program: the Town of Fallsburg, the Village of Jeffersonville, the Village of Monticello, the Town of Mamikating, and the Village of Wurtsboro, and the Town of Thompson. Thank you. Each municipality will receive a matching grant of $15,000 and will compete for a $100,000 capital grant secured by Assemblywoman Aileen Gunther. A second place winner of $50,000 and a third place winner of $25,000 will also be announced at our awards ceremony on August 7th. Here's a quick snapshot of some of the things these municipalities intend to accomplish this year. Seasonal employees will be hired to assist with beautification efforts in Fallsburg, Jeffersonville, Monticello, and Wurtsboro. Building on last year's efforts, the Town of Thompson plans to complete landscaping efforts along the 42 corridor, Monticello will complete the installation of four new welcome signs, and Fallsburg will continue enhancements to a pocket park and municipal lot in South Fallsburg. Finally, native landscaping and a nature trail will be added to a parcel in Mamikating recently acquired for use as an environmental education center. With code enforcement, both Monticello and Mamikating intend to hire additional staff to focus on enforcement of building and property maintenance codes, while Fallsburg will concentrate on removing eyesores and working with seasonal businesses. Monticello and Thompson are also currently working together on developing a gateway study and joint side guidelines, while Jeffersonville will be exploring opportunities to share code enforcement services with the town of Calicoon. Our new focus on building healthy communities was also incorporated into this program. We've seen that most of the proposed initiatives focuses on parks and trails, including a peace walk along the O&W in Fallsburg, work along the D&H Canal towpath in Mamikating, and expanding the Healthy Heart Trail in the town of Thompson. Jeffersonville also plans to do walking trail, while Monticello will focus on expanding its youth recreational offerings and promoting its farmers market. We are delighted that so many local officials rose to the occasion to meet our challenge, and we're especially proud of this year's grantees. At this time, I'm going to call them each up one at a time to accept their check, and if you could just stay on stage for a quick group photo, and then we'll just move on to some housekeeping for the afternoon. So accepting the award on behalf of the town of Fallsburg is Supervisor Steve Veglianti. Where are you, Steve? Steve was dressed for the weather today. He's out working, so that's why, you know, he's got his. All right, thank you. Just stand up there. Accepting the award on behalf of the Village of Jeffersonville is Mayor Bill Toney and Deputy Clerk Jane Losky. Come on up, guys. Also present today are Village Clerk Colleen Friedis and Trustee Bill Chellis. There we go. Accepting the award on behalf of the Village of Monticello is Village Manager David Sager, and also present is Trustee Jill Weyer, who refuses to come up on stage for some odd reason. Thank you, sir. Accepting the award on behalf of the Town of Mammocating and the Village of Wurtsboro is Deputy Supervisor Bob Fiore, Councilwoman Janet Leibolt, and also Mayor Mickey Marr. Say anything. And then finally, accepting the award on the behalf of the Town of Thompson is Deputy Administrator Patrice Chester. Supervisor Bill Reber was here earlier, but he had to leave to go stand in the cold at the St. Patrick's Day Parade, so we appreciate it. Thank you, Ms. Patrice. Can you get over there? Just give me a thumbs up, Nick, when you're all done. Okay, thank you. Thanks, guys. You can go up that way.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I need to briefly acknowledge some additional municipalities who will be receiving support from Sullivan Renaissance through another grant program called our Community Development Grant Program. These guys will not be participating in the competition, but we're glad to be partnering with them on issues of mutual concern. As I announce each grant, I'm just going to ask that any municipal officials present please stand and be recognized. So the Town of Bethel is going to receive $5,000 to hire a seasonal employee that will work alongside Bethel First volunteers on various beautification projects. Dan, would you mind standing? And anyone else from the Town of Bethel? Thank you. The Town of Forestburg will receive $5,000 to assist with the removal of eyesores along the Route 42 corridor. Town Supervisor couldn't be here today because he was out of town, but we're looking forward to working with him. The Town of Liberty will receive $5,000 to continue maintenance of the traffic circles and other public spaces throughout the town. Charlie, are you still here? Somewhere? Oh, there he is. Thank you. And I think Councilman Vince McPhillips was here as well. And then the Village of Liberty will receive $2,000 to expand their hanging basket program. So good luck to all of you with your projects. Okay, almost done. This concludes the morning session of our conference. Yay! I have a few details just to pass along before you get your food. There's a break now for a stretch, networking, and refreshments. If you're registered for the stretch and walk with Rennie, you're crazy. But Rennie will be at the registration table if you want to do that. We encourage you to use this time to network with one another, visit all the exhibitors and displays. We have some afternoon breakout sessions. At this point, we'll probably delay them a little bit. We'll try to start around 1:30 instead of 1 o'clock. That gives you time to network and grab some refreshments. We have Plants That Drink Responsibly in Classroom B, which is downstairs. Placemaking for Healthy Communities with Cynthia is right back here at the Event Gallery. And then we have Incorporating the Garden as a Teaching Tool, and our Volunteer Outreach Salon are also downstairs. We will have a door prize drawing after the afternoon session, probably about 2:30. You have to be here to win, and there are some upcoming dates that you may want to be aware of, but we'll go over them again later. So thank you all for coming out today. We look forward to working with each of you. Thank you for your patience, and enjoy the rest of the afternoon.